This conference will
Yeah, we
now
are
be
all fine, sir.
recorded.
Yes, we are all fine, sir. Okay, so here we are with the RAISE MRCOG of the Part 2 courses, and this is the free session which will be conducted by me. I am Dr. Rashmi Patil, the Director and Chief Mentor of RAISE Academy. I welcome all of you. And let me introduce to our course mentors. So, quickly going through the session. Yes, this is me, Dr. Rashmi Patil here, all of you can see. So I'll be introducing the other course mentors. Dr. Geetika, are you there?
Yeah, yes, Rashmi, am I audible?
Hi. Yes, you are audible, dear. So can you just
Yeah.
briefly tell about yourself to all of us? We are so
Yeah.
proud of you to be associated with us, and
Same
congratulations,
here,
and
Rashmi,
we
same
welcome you
here.
all.
Yeah. Thank you
Yes,
so much.
Geetika, go ahead. Yes.
Yeah, so, hello everyone. I hope you all are keeping safe and sound. So, talking about myself, I'm Dr. Geetika from Delhi. And I joined RAISE Academy around 1 2 months back. And Rashmi and me have already successfully run a marathon course for the exam going candidates part two, those who have given the exam just now. And it was a great success. Talking about me, I have done my MBBS, MD, DNB, and cleared my MRCOG also this year. Part three I cleared. And I have done my fellowship in ART and minimum access surgeries. Presently, I'm working as an assistant professor since 3 years in a medical college in Delhi, and I'm already teaching MD/MS candidates, students I'm teaching. And so, clearing MRCOG has been a lovely journey for me, frankly speaking. But the most important thing is that we should study the right thing in the right direction. So that is most important. Academics has always been very close to my heart, and just to say that there is no shortcut to hard work. There is no shortcut to it. You have to work hard to clear this exam in a go. And we all here in the RAISE Academy are there to help you out in clearing this prestigious exam. Our next batch is about to start from Tuesday for the September exam going candidates, and I wish all of you a great success in life. So thank you, Rashmi, from my side, and over to you now.
Yeah, thank you so much, Dr. Geetika. Dr. Siddesh, our next mentor, are you there?
Yes, I am here, Rashmi. Hi.
Hello, sir. Welcome to RAISE Academy and our part two courses. So I would like you to introduce yourself to our students. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. I am Dr. Siddesh Iyer. I am a consultant obstetrician and gynecologist practicing in Mumbai. I am also a DNB and a CPS teacher to candidates in a municipal hospital in Bombay. I have done my MBBS, then DGO, then DNB, and I cleared MRCOG in 2018 and have been training students since then. And teaching is my passion. I love to take clinics, classes, and I would like to say that MRCOG has changed my perspective towards practice in OBGY as well. Apart from training and teaching, I also do have my own hospital in Bombay. So in general, part three changes your approach to your patient, and it teaches you how to deal with patients, how to break bad news, how to treat an angry patient, how to debrief your patient. A lot of things it teaches you, which helps you in the long run, by a big deal. Some of you may want to go to the UK, hence you are preparing for the part three. Some of you just may want an academic qualification, a good foreign degree to your name. But I would like to tell you that the bottom line of this exam is that, come what may, it is going to change you as a person. It is going to change the way you approach your patients. It is going to change the way your patients look at you. The time you spend with them is going to be quality time. And we are here to help you clear this exam, train you, as Dr. Geetika said and Dr. Rashmi said, in the right direction such that your approach to your patients changes for the better and in a manner that the exam expects you to answer, which I think is a life lesson and not just an exam lesson, which I took from my mentors when I cleared my exam. So all the best to all of you. We at Raise Academy are here to help you out with all your difficulties. And if anything is needed at any time, we are all just a call away. So all the best to you and back to you, Rashmi. Thank you so much for having me in Raise Academy.
Thank you so much, sir, to be associated with us. And you rightly said that, yes, it is not only an exam, but it changes the perspective towards our patients and the entire outlook towards ops and gyne. Thank you so much, sir. Dr. Achisman, sir, are you there? Hello, sir. How are you doing?
Hi. Right. I'm fine. Thank you so much. Is it my turn?
Yes, sir, definitely. And I must say that in the marathon course, what the biostatistics that you had taken for all our students, it really helped them because almost close to 15 questions were there from statistics and they could solve it easily, sir. And all that credit goes to you. Thank you so much for taking that session for them.
Well, thank you so much. That's very heartening to learn.
Yes,
I'm Archisman. Right. So shall I go ahead with the introduction?
Yes, sir. Please go ahead.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Rashmi, for this opportunity to get associated with Raise Academy. I'm Archisman Mahapatra. My background is in community medicine. I did my MBBS from Cuttack. I grew up in Odisha. My MBBS is from Cuttack, and then I did my MD in community medicine from Banaras Hindu University. And then been over 10 years now into epidemiology and public health research. So I was working as the Deputy Director of Research of International Clinical Epidemiology Network. And for the past couple of years now, heading GRID Council, which again is for multi-site epidemiological studies. So thanks for this great association. It's wonderful interacting with people. And I take up the biostatistics portion of this training and try my best to solve it. I have some real life experience of managing research data. And I think that that will give some kind of conceptual approach to the questions. It's very gladdening to learn that the previous cohort could solve the biostat questions. And I hope that even the present cohort going forward will also find it very exciting trying to solve biostat questions. They're very high marks earning. And of course, MRCOG is a very coveted certification. And if understanding biostatistics and solving those questions helps you to achieve success in that examination, that's very gratifying indeed. Thank you so much for this association.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. And looking forward to the next biostatistic session from for the next batches. Thank you, sir. So we do have Dr. Rupali Bansal. She's an obstetrician and gynecologist working at University Hospitals and Leicester NHS Trust, UK. So she'll be joining us in the part two, the part one, and the part three MRCOG, and she'll be dealing with the clinical governance and the NHS system. So we'll be getting the firsthand experience of all the things that we want and all the queries that we are having regarding the NHS system, be it any minute thing, so we can just talk to her and get back to all those queries solved. Yes, so let's start the journey. So I wanted all the mentors to be introduced first, and now it's my turn. So I'm Dr. Rashmi Patil. I have done my MBBS from Davangere, Karnataka, and I did my post-graduation from SIAN Mumbai. So it had been a beautiful journey. Then I cleared my DNB exam. I did fellowship in laparoscopy and infertility, and the ultrasound, and now the MRCOG was my passion again. So I have cleared that MRCOG in 2019. And teaching has always been my dream, and setting Raise Academy, this was a vision because I wanted to help the students to go in the right direction and getting associated with wonderful mentors. Yes, we as a team are here to help you all in solving all the questions and getting the right approach towards the exam. So looking forward to the next batches, and let us start the journey of today's session. So today I'll be covering two important topics, the external cephalic version and reducing the incidence of term breach presentation. This was a Green Top guideline which was introduced in March 2017. And many recalls do come from here. There are lots of percentages. The first one is the breach presentation. It complicates around 3 to 4% of the term deliveries. Yes, we have been learning since ages that yes, breach is 3 to 4%. So we should go by this presentation and remember this percentage for an exam point of view. Women should be informed that the success rate of ECV is approximately 50%. So you can remember that you have two women who are there for the ECV, and then both of the women, you have done the extracephalic version. One woman, it is successful, the other woman, it is not. So 50% is the success rate of external cephalic version. This you should remember. This split apart in the primary as well as the multiparous. So going by the statistics and other things, it is shown that the success rate for the multiparous has been a little higher, 60%. And for the nulliparous, it has been a little lower, that is 40%. So do remember, we have two women there. One of them was successful, the other one it was not. So the success rate is 50%. If that woman was a multipara, then it is 60. If the other one was a nullipara, it is going to be 40. Now the spontaneous version from breach to cephalic is unusual at term, but yes, it can happen, and occurs in only 8% of the primary gravidae after 36 weeks of gestation. Now we did a scan at 36 weeks and we saw that it was a breach presentation. Now to turn the baby from the breach to the cephalic, you can remember that as a figure of 8, the baby head turns from the from the breach round to the cephalic. So this is going to be like a figure of 8. The baby is turning from breach to cephal again. So this percentage, a spontaneous version, which can happen after 36 weeks of gestation, we can remember that as 8%. So remember like this, in the figure of 8, the baby turns from being the breach to the cephal. Now where ECV at term has been unsuccessful, two large series demonstrated that 3 to 7% of babies were spontaneously turned to cephalic presentation. Now, these were the people where nothing has been tried, but when ECV at term has been unsuccessful, again, close to that percent only, you can remember that they may turn spontaneously to cephalic presentation. Now, we all know that the breach presentation at term is 3 to 4%, correct? Now, we did an ECV. It was successful. Now, the baby decided, no, let me go back to this 3 to 4%. So, spontaneous reversion to breach after a successful ECV is rare, but the occurring could be again in 3%. Yes, so we have done the ECV. The baby decided, no, I have to go back to the initial percentages. So after successful ECV, the spontaneous reversion to breach is again 3%. So this you should remember in this way. So am I clear with all these percentages? How you're going to remember? At the presentation term, it is 3 to 4. Then later, we did ECV for two women. One of them was successful, the other one was not. So the success rate is 50. Going back that she could be a multipara, it is a little higher, 60. Then nullipara, it is 40. Now spontaneous version, we know the baby in the figure of 8, it does the somersault and then it becomes to cephalic. So remember, it has a figure of 8 as 8%. Somewhere close to that is after the unsuccessful ECV. Then after spontaneous reversion to breach, the successful ECV is again, after this successful ECV, the spontaneous reversion, it again goes back initial percentage. So this is again 3%. So all these are important things. So give me a thumbs up or just write that yes kind thing. If you all understood this percentage, then we are going to the next slide. I want all of you to remember these percentages. Am I clear with the percentages? Yes, very good. Thank you so much. Now, what about the tocolysis? So it is seen that the success rate with the tocolysis with beta mimetics, it improves. The routine use of the regional analgesia and the neuraxial blockade, it is not recommended. So in case if you get any EMQ and these are the options given, do not go by this. You have to consider that it improves with the tocolysis with the beta mimetics. Another recall, when are you going to offer this ECV? So ECV should be offered at term from 37 weeks of gestation. In the nulliparous woman, however, it can be offered a week earlier. So remember, she's a nulliparous. So 1 week earlier at 36 weeks itself, you are going to offer an ECV for her. Whereas considering this should be offered at term, so we go, if the multiparous is given in the option, we have to go by 37. If the nulliparous is given, please choose the option as 36 plus 0 weeks of gestation. There is a paucity of data on the intrapartum ECV, but success has been reported. And intrapartum ECV may be considered if informed consent is possible before itself and providing the membranes are still intact and there is no other contraindication that exists. Then only you can do an intrapartum ECV. Now, there is no general consensus on the eligibility for all the contraindications for the ECV. So in general, there is no exactly any contraindications or general consensus on this. But women should be informed that after one cesarean, after one cesarean, it appears to have no greater risk than the unscarred uterus. So the risk remains the same. Be it one cesarean or having an unscarred uterus also, the risk remains same. There is no other significant increase in the risk rate. What are the exact contraindications which we can think about? A placental abruption, severe preeclampsia, abnormal fetal Doppler or the cardiotocography. These are supported by some evidence. So what we are doing in this, do you think that in such situations we are going to do the ECV and try to deliver the baby by vaginal methods? No. We are going to do an emergency cesarean for them. So these remain the contraindications for doing an ECV, right? So ECV is contraindicated where an absolute reason for cesarean section already exists. For example, there's a placenta previa major. There is no path for the baby to come out, right? So you are not going to try any ECV in such situation because you have to do an cesarean section for such situations. In it's generally considered that to be contraindicated when first is the multiple pregnancy, except after the first delivery of the twin. So when both the babies are there, you cannot try to do any such things. Rhesus isoimmunization, for example, by the chance that there could be some fetomaternal transfusion also. The current or the recent, less than 1 week, she had some vaginal bleeding. So do not manipulate her uterus. Abnormal electronic fetal monitoring. So don't try out anything on the baby. You can directly go for cesarean. If the membranes are ruptured, there is no enough liquid to do such manipulation. So please do not try out anything on these. The mother declines. This is very important. The mother declines or she's unable to give the informed consent. You're not going to try anything like that. Additional caution where there is oligohydramnios or the mother has an hypertension. So these are generally considered to be contraindicated. Now, this is again a recall. The reported risk of emergency cesarean section within 24 hours is 0.5%. So the patient, you did an ECV, you sent her home with all the red flag signs that if in case if you have any bleeding or anything like that, then immediately come back to us. So in that situation, within 24 hours, it is seen that 0.5% of women, they come back to us and they end up having an emergency cesarean section. With the indication in over 90% being a vaginal bleeding, or it could be an abnormal CTG following the procedure. So whenever we do an ECV, we have to monitor the baby. We do an CTG and then see like what are the findings in that. Some patients may have an abnormal CTG. In such a situation, we go by emergency cesarean section and everything will be explained to these mothers beforehand itself and a consent will be taken regarding the same that such and such complication can arise and you may end up in having an emergency cesarean. But majority of them within these 24 hours, like in over 90%, they came with a vaginal bleeding. And these women ended up in having an emergency cesarean section and that rate is 0.5%. What about the fetal safety that we have to consider? The facilities for monitoring and the surgical delivery, it should be available. Then following the ECV, electronic fetal monitoring is recommended. We should do this. Women undergoing the ECV who are D negative should undergo the testing for the fetal-maternal hemorrhage and offer anti-D. So this we have to consider. Whenever you're manipulating the uterus, you have to consider the fetal-maternal hemorrhage, and they should undergo the testing, and they should be offered anti-D. So all these three fetal safety points you should remember. Minimum of 500 international units is recommended within 72 hours. We have to follow this guideline. And in case if there is extra fetal maternal hemorrhage, then we are going to titrate the dose and add them. Now, how many attempts can you do? No more than 4 attempts are advised, and for a suggested of maximum of 10 minutes interval overall. So only 4 attempts you can do. A transient, that is less than 3 minutes, fetal bradycardia could be there, and this is common, but should instigate a continuous monitoring in a left lateral position. And if this is going to be persistent, and if this is not improving after 6 minutes, you should promptly prepare the patient for a category 1 cesarean section. All these words are important. Initially, how many minutes are going to monitor? You are going to monitor for 3 minutes. But if the fetal bradycardia is there and it is like less than 3 minutes, nothing to worry. If it is more than 3 minutes, you should worry regarding like what things are happening and put the patient in the left lateral position and see if this is going to be persistent or it is not improving even after 6 minutes. Then you are going to do a category 1. It is not category 2. Any CTG problems here, which is immediately telling that the baby is getting compromised, you have to rush. So it should be a category 1 cesarean section. Women may wish to consider the use of moxibustion for the breech presentation at 30 to 35 weeks of gestation under the guidance of trained practitioner. Now, this is a kind where moxibustion is a kind of a therapy where they put some kind of incense sticks near the foot, and that smell, it stimulates the fetal movements. And then the baby starts moving excessively, and sometimes it may do the somersault and change its position. This could be considered between 33 to 35 weeks, according to the guideline. And it says it should be under the guidance of a trained practitioner. It shouldn't be tried by any person else. So only under the trained practitioner, this, if the woman wish to consider this particular treatment, she can go for that between 33 to 35 weeks of gestation. However, this question has not been asked yet. So that was regarding the ECV, the percentages that you're supposed to remember when you're going to offer. Yes, we all know that the going for the quick revision, it is your 3%, 3 to 4% at the term. Then 50% it was successful, 60 in the multi, 40 in the primary. Remember, it is higher in the multi. Because their abdomen is lax, you're able to manipulate well. So it is higher in the multi and little less in your nulliparous. Then 8% will do the somersault by themselves and they revert back to the kefal by themselves after 35 weeks. All these things are important. The sentences, like the words like after 35 weeks, 8%, spontaneous version, all these are important. Somehow they are close to 3 to 7% after like ECV has been unsuccessful, the other babies have turned. And spontaneous reversion, these babies choose to enter the initial percentage group. So it is again 3%. When it is going to be offered, 36 for the nulliparous and 37 plus weeks for the multipara. And these are the contraindications that we should remember, which necessitates immediate cesarean section. Now, after the emergency cesarean section, the rate is 0.5%, and 90% of women, they present with a vaginal bleeding. Somehow, other people could be because of the abnormal CTG. And anti-D has to be considered, no more than 4 attempts, maximum of 10 minutes. A CTG, a fetal bradycardia of 3 minutes, necessitates continuous monitoring again in a left lateral position. Even not improving after 6 minutes, you're going to go for a CAT1 cesarean section. So this is a quick revision regarding the ECV and all the points which are being covered. They are most of them, they are all the recalls. So you should remember all these key points, summarizing your GTG and focusing on what you should remember. This is important. So these slides are crisp and clear. And if you go by these slides, then you'll be able to solve your exam questions from this guideline. Am I clear with this guideline now? Shall I go ahead with the next one? Yes, just write down in the chat box here. Okay, clear. Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you. Yes, going ahead with the management of breach presentation. This guideline, again, it is 20B. It was published again along with the previous guideline. It is in March 2017. So, which are the patients? These are the higher risk for the planned vaginal breach. And there are certain independent indications which will necessitate a cesarean section. So where you are not supposed to do an ECV or you are not supposed to allow for a vaginal breach delivery. These are very high risk patients. What are these indications now? Hyperextended neck on the ultrasound. So this is a star-gazing appearance of the baby. Baby refuses to come down. So it is hyperextended neck on the ultrasound. Baby weight is on the higher side or on the lower side. Higher side means 3.8. So in such situation, we cannot offer a vaginal, planned vaginal birth because this weight is large enough. Anything like low estimated weight, the fetal head will be larger than the body. So the body comes out and the head gets stuck. So the aftercoming head gets stuck. We all know that in a low estimated weight or a preterm, it could be the head getting stuck over there. So any baby who is on the less than 10th centile, please do not put the stress for the baby to have a vaginal delivery. Foot link presentation, again, a clear no-no because the feet come down through the not fully dilated cervix and then the body gets stuck. So foot link presentation is a clear no. The cord could get compressed and baby could be compromised. And if there is any evidence of the antenatal fetal compromise, you are not going to try for any planned vaginal breach. Okay, so everyone mute yourself. Yeah, thank you. Okay, these are the recalls now. What information about the baby should be given to the mother with a breech presentation at term regarding the mode of delivery? What all things you are going to tell her? A planned cesarean section. This leads to a small reduction in the perinatal mortality compared to the planned vaginal breech delivery. All these words are important. So whenever you have a planned cesarean versus a planned vaginal, when you do a cesarean section, this is going to cause a small reduction in the perinatal mortality, okay, for the baby. So we are not considering the mother here because cesarean poses more high risk for the mother. So it is the perinatal mortality, not even the morbidity, the mortality is reduced when you're going for a planned cesarean section. Now, the reduced risk is due to three factors. One is avoiding the stillbirth, which can happen after 39 weeks, avoidance of all the intrapartum risk that the baby has to undergo, and the last one, which is very unique to the breech baby itself, like hyperextended, higher weight, lower weight, so anything which is unique to the baby there. So all these risk factors will make a planned vaginal breech delivery more complicated, and the risk for having the risk of increased regional anesthesia, we'll discuss here, all these things. So all these things are going. You mean for the breech one, the ECV, regional? So here I have mentioned here, routine use of regional analgesia or neuraxial blockade is not recommended and considered for a repeat attempt for a woman unable to tolerate without analgesia. Okay, am I clear with this slide? Routinely, it is not recommended here. Yes, thank you. Thank you. Okay, so we should remember that the planned cesarean has a good point for the baby compared to the mother. Now, this is really important, the risk of perinatal mortality. Cesarean section after 39 weeks, we know it is 0.5 in 1,000. In a planned cephalic birth, this is going to be 1 in 1,000. But when this cephal becomes breech and you are trying a vaginal delivery for the baby in a planned manner, this gets doubled. So it is 2 out of 1,000. Okay. So the least is whenever you're doing cesarean, this is only related to the perinatal mortality, not even the morbidity, not even the mother. This is only the baby's death that we are thinking about. So obviously we know that whenever we are doing a cesarean after 39, the rate that the baby could die is very less. It is 0.5 out of 1000. Now we allow a baby, a Kefal baby and a vaginal breech baby. So we know that the Kefal baby has a less chance compared to the vaginal breech. Breech delivery will have more complications. There is a chance that baby could die because of the process of labor. So this is going to be a little higher. So if Kefal we consider something as a standard as 1 per 1000, this is going to be 2 per 1000. These three incidents, this is very important. So you should remember them. Caesarean has the least. Next is the Kefal and next is the vaginal breech. Now, women should be informed that the planned vaginal breech birth, it increases the risk of low OCA score and serious short-term complications. But it has not shown to increase the risk of long-term morbidity. So this you should remember. Whenever the baby has undergone a planned vaginal breech birth, so immediately the baby could face some problem. Some serious problems also, some low Apgar score also. But when you compare later, like 5 years down the lane, 10 years down the lane, it is shown that it is not increases any risk of long-term morbidity in the baby. The baby could experience certain short-term complications, but not the long-term one. So all this will come as an EMQ for you people. So it is serious long-term complication, serious short-term complication, then not increases serious like short-term or serious long-term. So all these terminologies are really important. So as soon as the baby is born by the breech, immediately baby could have some problem. And it could have a serious problem, but it is going to be for a short term. When you compare such babies when they are grown up, they do not have the risk of long-term morbidity. There is no like proper comparison. They are almost as par with their peers. So a planned vaginal breech, we have to explain this to mother that initially there could be a problem, but later on, there won't be such serious long-term morbidities. Now, what about elective cesarean section? This will have a protective effect on the perinatal mortality. We saw here 0.5, it is there, as well as the short term. But probably again, the long-term morbidity and all, it cannot comment upon. But whatever short-term problems the baby had in the vaginal breech delivery, the elective cesarean section is going to have a protective effect. So this is very much logical that yes, immediately the baby will not have any such problem, but it cannot really comment upon the long-term morbidity. Now there was a study, the Premoda study, which is highlighted in the guideline. So it has done, it has come up with a lot of information for us. So few of them I have included. The woman should be informed that the planned cesarean section for a breech presentation at the term, it carries a small risk of immediate complications to the mother. So can you see, whenever there is a cesarean, the mother is going to have some complications, right? She is undergoing a surgery. But whenever there is a cesarean, the baby is going to be delivered safely here when compared to your planned vaginal breech delivery. So this can come as an EMQ for her. This is going to have a small increase in immediate complications to the mother compared to the planned vaginal breech. In vaginal breech also, she can have tears. I agree to that. But the complications which are there in the cesarean are more compared to this. Now, women should be informed that the maternal complications are least with successful vaginal birth. The planned cesarean carries a higher risk, but the risk is highest with emergency cesarean section. So you can have the scenario that one mother, she has a successful vaginal breech delivery. The other mother is also undergoing a trial for a vaginal breech birth, but due to some problems, she had to undergo an emergency cesarean section. Now she's in between now. She had neither a successful vaginal birth. She neither had a planned emergency, like planned cesarean section. She's stuck in between these two women. So she underwent all the things that a vaginal breech mother had to go. Now she's undergoing the things that a cesarean mother had to go. But this situation is an emergency. So this mother, she is at the highest risk of maternal complication. Am I clear this with this point? We have three mothers here. One had a successful vaginal birth. The other had a successful cesarean section electively after 39 weeks. The other mother is stuck between. She gave a trial and she ended up with having an emergency cesarean. So this mother is going to have the highest risk. Now, how many percentage will have the emergency cesarean is, if you take 100 women who are undergoing the vaginal birth, 40 of them will have an emergency. So it is 40%. This is a recall. So if there are 100 women who are undergoing the trial, 40 are going to have an emergency cesarean section. 60 will have a successful vaginal birth over here. Okay? This is very important. Do remember. Okay. Now, breech at term, it is not diagnosed until labor. It could be like, you know, the patient is under just the midwife care or something, and because of the high BMI or something, they couldn't make out whether it was a kyphal or a breech, and there is no ultrasound done near the term, and this patient came in labor. And suddenly you see that this patient is having a breech presentation. This happens in 25% of the women. So this is again a recall. So this is the percentage you should remember. It is 25%. Women should be informed that induction of labor is not usually recommended. So this could be one of your EMQ. So induction of the labor is not recommended for the breech. Now, augmentation of slow progress with the oxytocin should only be considered if the contraction frequency is low. And that too in presence of an epidural analgesia. So the patient is having analgesia and then the progression is very slow. In that condition, you can consider augmentation with oxytocin. Women should be informed that effect of the epidural analgesia on the success of the vaginal birth is still unclear, but that it is likely to increase the risk of intervention. Intervention in the time the mother may not be able to cooperate with the delivery, so you may have to do some intervention, some manipulation. So in such situation, it may increase the risk. Now, women should be informed that while the evidence is lacking, continuous electronic fetal monitoring may lead to improved neonatal outcome. Okay, whenever you're doing something and you can pick up that the baby is not doing fine, then you're going to intervene and have a good outcome for the baby. So continuous electronic fetal monitoring is there, but this is not yet evidence-based or evidence-proven. Women should be informed that cesarean section increases the risk of complications in future pregnancy, including the risk of options for the VBAC, increased risk of complications like a repeat cesarean, risk of abnormally invasive placenta. So we all know that whenever she has a cesarean, the next pregnancy is not devoid of complications, right? So it is going to increase the complication in the future pregnancies. Now, women should be given an individualized assessment of the long-term risk of the cesarean section based on their individual risk profile and reproductive intention. She may wish to have a large family, like I want 4 or 5 children. And now you're counseling her for cesarean section versus the planned vaginal breech. So you can encourage her that if she has a planned vaginal breech and if it is successful, she can avoid a cesarean, then her wish of having a large family, that could be smooth journey rather than having a scarred uterus. So you have to counsel this regarding all these points. Now, emergency cesarean, as we know, with a plan, it was 40%. So the range that they gave is 29 to 45%. So being very much clear in your exam, if they give you a single percentage, please choose 40%. If they are giving you a range, it is mentioned in the guideline as 29 to 45%. Okay, you should remember this point. The planned cesarean, when it is compared with the planned vaginal birth, it is going to cause a threefold increase in the uterine scarring. So you should remember that whenever planned cesarean is there, and then you're comparing with the planned vaginal birth ending up again with the cesarean section. So a planned cesarean, definitely more and more candidates, so cesarean is going to have a uterine scarring. So there is a threefold increase in such a situation. Now, the risk of blood transfusion, we know that endometritis, need for hysterectomy, and even death, these are increased with the previous cesarean section. the risk of abnormal invasion of the placenta increases from 0.31 from one cesarean to 2.3 with the four cesareans and all. So subsequently, it goes on increasing the risk of invasion. The risk of delivery-related perinatal mortality after one cesarean is 12.9. However, these percentages have not been asked in the exam, so it was just written for you people to have a glance. Now, birth in a hospital with facilities for immediate cesarean section, everything should be arranged for them. Appropriate case selection is very much important. Management according to a strict protocol should be followed, and there should be skilled attendants who are taking care of her. Adequate descent of the breech in the passive second stage is a prerequisite for encouragement for the active second stage. So whenever the patient is there, there is good adequate descent is happening, and that is regarding your passive second stage, then you have to encourage her during that active part. Now, these are very much important, so just focus on these points here. The first stage of labor follows the same principles as in cephalic presentation. So do not change your management plan. So be it a cephalic delivery or be it a breech delivery, the first stage of labor remains the same. The same principles you are going to apply. Now, reducing the risk of cord compression, amniotomy is reserved for definitive clinical indication only. Otherwise, do not perform early amniotomy in case of the breech presentation. Where the progression is very slow, you may consider cesarean section in such women. Epidural analgesia and the contraction frequency fewer than 4 in 10. In that situation, you may consider oxytocin. A passive second stage to allow the descent for the breech. So breech has to climb the perineum prior that as she start pushing actively is recommended. So let the breech come towards the perineum by itself. Let the breech climb the perineum by itself. And then you have going to encourage her active pushing. If the breech is not visible within 2 hours of the passive second stage, please undergo ask her to undergo cesarean section. Okay, you're going to give her 2 hours for the passive second stage. Yes, preterm breech is very important. How you are going to manage the preterm, this will depend upon the gestational age also. Now, we all know that whereas the low birth weight, less than 10th centile, we were not allowing for the vaginal delivery. Here, routine cesarean for the breech in spontaneous preterm labor, this is not recommended, but it has to be considered. So routinely, you're not going to recommend. You're going to discuss all the pros and cons, and then you're going to consider. Okay? Cesarean section for breech presentation in spontaneous preterm labor at the threshold of viability, whenever the baby is between 22 and 25 plus 6, whenever you don't know whether the baby is going to be viable or not, in such situation, when you do a cesarean section, this is not routinely recommended. You have to consider whether to allow this mother to have a vaginal breech delivery because the baby may or may not be viable. So whenever there is a threshold of viability doubt, please do not recommend cesarean section. Have a discussion and let her decide. So you are not going to routinely recommend a cesarean section. A planned cesarean section is recommended for the preterm breech presentation where the delivery is planned due to mother or the fetal compromise. Previously itself it was planned and then she came in preterm breech labor. For her, you're going to recommend the cesarean section. Now, this is very important recall. So always remember this particular figure. Many times they give this figure. They can give you as 4, 8, 12 also, but what the guideline recommend is 2, 6, and 10. So whenever there is a head entrapment, which can happen in 14% of the vaginal deliveries, okay? So in such a situation, incisions at 2, 6, and 10 o'clock, this is recommended. Okay, it is in the form like this. So 2, 6 and 10 o'clock, this incision is recommended by the guideline. They can give you different numbers. This was a recall. They can give you different numbers, but do remember this figure. And head entrapment can happen in 14% of the vaginal deliveries. head entrapment at cesarean section delivery, it can happen. So what you're going to do? So you have to extend that uterine incision. So we know this is the cut that we give. We are going to extend it one way up. So it is a J shape. Or this is the cut that we have given. We are going to, from the center, we are going to extend it up. So it is an inverted T. So these two things are done whenever there is a head entrapment in the cesarean section. What about the twin delivery? So a planned cesarean section for a twin pregnancy where the presenting twin is a breech, that is recommended. Whenever the presenting twin is a kephal, you can consider a vaginal delivery. But whenever the presenting twin means the one which is occupying the lower uterine segment and which is overlying the os, so that presenting twin is breech here, then please recommend a planned cesarean section for her. This is a very important EMQ. They'll give you a scenario and they will tell you that the presenting twin is breech. Please select planned cesarean section for the option. Okay. Now, routine emergency cesarean section for the breech. The first twin in spontaneous labor, however, is not recommended. So they say that routinely, whenever they come in a spontaneous labor, it is not recommended, but it should be considered. Have a discussion with the mother. A routine cesarean section for the breech presentation for the second twin is not recommended in either term or preterm. So you can consider other options. For example, in this situation, the routine cesarean, we should say that it is not recommended. It can be only considered if there are any other associated problem. Only when the mother is not in labor and she is presenting with the first twin, which is breech, you are going to select the planned cesarean. If she comes in spontaneous labor, the terms that you're going to use is what the guidelines say is it is not recommended. But you can consider, have a discussion with the mother. And even when the second twin is breech, even then the cesarean section is not routinely recommended. Now, the second twin is non-vertex at the time of delivery. It happens in 40%. So many 40% we have been encountering in the breech guidelines. So the second twin, which is non-vertex at the time of delivery, we find it as 40%. And we know that 40% of the breech patients, they go in for emergency cesarean section also. So dear students, this was all regarding the breech, the ECV and the breech management in labor. I hope all of you enjoyed it and the points are clear for you all. All the points were discussed, keeping the exam questions in mind, the single best answers and the EMQs. So this was a crisp presentation regarding what the guideline usually says and how you should read a guideline, how you should focus on the important points that have been asked in the previous exams, and how you should manipulate all the words as recommendations, consider, then everything planned. So all these things, the words are very catchy. So you should remember where to focus, how to read a guideline and focus them, because the part two, it is considered the toughest among all the three parts. But yes, for the fact that the EMQs are there, single best answers you can easily choose. But when it comes to EMQ, your algorithm, your management, your guideline should be crystal clear. And we all are here to help you out with this. So RAISE Academy is presenting the long course for the January batch, and the September course is already, the batch has been enrolled and we are beginning from Tuesday onwards. So looking forward for all our batch students from Tuesday. And we are starting the long course, which is aiming at the January batch. This is again, 25 live sessions will be there beginning from the August. So weekly sessions are being conducted. Then the question pool access will be there. Then we are building up the library for the summaries for the GTCs and talks, so which will be made available soon. And there will be a mock exam at the end for all of you to practice. So the course fees, you can just message me on this number. So the details will be shared in the website as well as in the group. So just message me on this number to know the course fees. And we are the mentors here. We are all ready to help you out and guide you all through the success journey. And a very happy studying from the team RAISE Academy. It was lovely having you all. Hi dear, can we have the recording please? Yes dear, the recording will be made available, so it will be uploaded I think maximum by tomorrow morning it will be there. Thank you so much Kartika, it was wonderful and useful session. Thank you so much dear. Thank you all.
Can you, ma'am, can I ask one question?
Yes, may I know who is it? Only the number is being displayed dear.
Ma'am, myself Amita. And ma'am, if the breach is 26 weeks or 28 weeks or it is 30 weeks, you just explained. Can you, ma'am, repeat once
yeah.
more?
Yeah, so you have to go by this guideline. The preterm breach, okay? So whenever there is a routine cesarean section in the spontaneous preterm labor, this is usually not recommended. Okay, so this is the threshold of viability where you need to discuss. It is not routinely recommended a cesarean, but routine cesarean for the breech who comes in spontaneous labor also, this is not recommended. Now, planned cesarean section is recommended for preterm breech where the present where the patient has come and previously there were some indications for her to undergo a cesarean section because of her own conditions. Or the baby is being compromised. For example, like a severely growth restricted baby, or there are some the placental problems. Then there are Doppler changes where you are already planned for her. Okay. So in this situation only the preterm breach. As I told before, these are the indications and the contraindications. So here, if you see the high risk for the planned vaginal breach, which are the high risk points? It is a hyperextended weight more than 3.8. The low weight, which is less than 10th centile, it is not meaning the preterm, but it is telling the low birth weight, I mean the low estimated weight, which is less than the 10th centile. Foot length, then evidence of antenatal fetal compromise.
Ma'am, baby
okay?
will be
in such situation. Yes.
We do compromised baby cesarean, then also the prognosis will not be good.
Yes, dear. I do understand. I do agree that all these things are there in the background of mind. When it comes to clinical practice, these things, yes, we do consider. But in the exam, we have to go by what the RCOG guideline recommends us. We cannot put our own practice into their recommendations, right? And what do they recommend routinely for a preterm, like spontaneous preterm labor has come? You're not going to do a routine cesarean section. Okay. You're going to discuss these things with the mother. This is what RCOG says. So it is
yes.
not routinely recommended, but you need to discuss with the mother all these points. Whenever the patient comes in a threshold, whenever the patient comes in the threshold of viability, this is not routinely recommended. You have to discuss again. Now, a planned cesarean is recommended where you have already previously decided that this patient has to undergo cesarean because either the mother has some problem or the baby has some problem. Okay. Only in such situation where prior it was decided and this patient ended up having a preterm breech presentation, only in such situation you are going to recommend a planned cesarean or that particular emergency cesarean. Okay, you are not going to give a trial. But when the patient has come in a spontaneous preterm labor and having a breech, the RCOG does not recommend routinely the cesarean section. These are the exact sentences from the guideline. And you should learn it the same way for the exam, dear. The clinical okay. practice, it completely varies, okay? So for the exam point of view, just go by the guidelines. So this was wonderful session. Lovely having all of you. And a crisp presentation. Sorry for my bad throat. So I'll be seeing all the course students again in the Tuesday batch. So we are having first session by Dr. Geetika and followed the subsequently by me in this coming week. And if anybody like wants to enroll for the January batch, the link will be shared. So from tomorrow, you can just inquire about this also. All the links, everything are getting ready. So the thing will be shared and you can roll in for the January batch. So happy studying, all of you all. Take care and stay safe. Have a great time. Bye-bye. Thank you.